Baba 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 ba I said, before you, there is none, Lord. You created the heavens and the earth and everything that is in it. We will not give your glory to any other God. We acknowledge you tonight. We thank you for your presence in this place tonight. We thank you, Father, that you have called us out of darkness into your marvelous light. We thank you that you brought us all, Father, from the old into the new. Father, we thank you that you lifted us from the miry clay and you washed us and placed us on a hill, Lord. You took us out of darkness and brought us into your marvelous light. We thank you. We honor you. We thank you for the price that was paid for us, Lord. The price for God. It cost Jesus' blood for us to stand here tonight. It cost him his blood. Father, we thank you for demonstrating your love to us in that while we were so sinners, you cost your beloved Son Jesus Christ to die for us. There is no one like you. You are the one true God. And forever and ever we will worship you. Tonight we pray in the name of Jesus. The Lord, by the time we leave here, the chains of sin would have been broken. Father, the chains of sin, the chains of the flesh would have been broken. And we would begin to live a life that you have called us to live. The life that you prepared for us before the foundations of the earth. We bless you, Lord. Yes, indeed, you are God. Yes, indeed, you are God. Yes, indeed, you are Lord. Yes, indeed, you are Lord. And as your subjects, your servants, your children, we will forever worship you. We will forever worship you, Lord. We will forever honor you and glorify you. Take your glory tonight. Take it all tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Speak to us tonight, Holy Spirit. Bless us when we come and listen to you. The missions that we will be in this time. And we will begin to walk and live according to your will. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Beloved in the Lord, if you can go, you know, and go to the Lord, we're going to continue from where we left off last week. Beloved in the Lord, the Lord is really impressing upon us. It's really, it is really impressing on us that we need to let people understand the truth, know the truth, know the mysteries, know what God is saying concerning us. Amen. And that's why we are here tonight. And last week we all know we were speaking on the subject, we have an obligation. We have an obligation. Hallelujah. And we'll read from Romans chapter 8, verses 12 to 17. We'll read from three different verses. We'll read the NIV, we'll read the King James, and we'll read the Amplified. So if you can just do it there quickly, then we will do that. Okay, therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation. We have an obligation. But that obligation, according to the Bible, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. Hallelujah. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God, not those who are led by the flesh. The Spirit you receive, the Spirit you receive as a Christian, does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. Hallelujah. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. 17. Now. If we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also do what? You need to share in the suffering before you share in the glory. If there is no crucifixion, there is no resurrection. Crucifixion must come before resurrection. Hallelujah. King James. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors with the God. Hallelujah. Because he bought you with his blood, you owe something. But you don't owe to the flesh. He says, we are debtors not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. Stop giving those excuses. For if we live after the flesh, we shall die. But if you, through the Spirit, do mortify, till, hallelujah, mortify. When somebody dies and they embalm him, the person becomes what? Mortified. Hallelujah. And so we need mortifying rather the spirit and living according to the flesh. But if you, through the Spirit, do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Not everybody. Hallelujah. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so, be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Hallelujah. So then, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation. We are debtors, and we have an obligation. But not to our flesh, our human nature, our worldliness, our sinful capacity to live according to the impulses of the flesh, our nature without the Holy Spirit. For if you are living according to the impulses of the flesh, you are going to die. But if you are living by the power of the Holy Spirit, you are habitually putting to death the sinful deeds of the body. You will really live forever. For all who are allowing themselves to be led by the Spirit of God are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of slavery, leading again to fear of God's judgment, but you have received the spirit of adoption, Our sons, the Spirit produces sonship by which we joyfully cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies and confirms together with our spirit, assuring us that we, believers, are children of God. 17. And if we are his children, then we are his heirs also. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, sharing his spiritual blessing and inheritance. If indeed we share in his suffering, so that we may also share in his glory. Hallelujah. Beloved in the Lord, we have an obligation. We have an obligation. What is an obligation? What is an obligation? Obligation is a moral or legal requirement. A moral or legal requirement. I'll give you much more definitions. It is also a service or favor for which one is indebted. That is why you saw that the Bible says we are what? Debtors. It also means an act or cause of action to which a person is morally or legally bound, a duty or commitment. Hallelujah. I will go over it again because it looks like I'm a little bit fast. It's an obligation, is a moral or legal requirement. In other words, duty. It is also a service or favor for which one is indebted. Again, it is also an act or cause of action to which a person is morally. I love the word morally. Because people always want to talk about the fact that Christianity is not legalistic and all that. Yes, but this is the obligation if you have a moral obligation. Hallelujah. So, which a person is morally or legally bound. So, you are morally bound. A duty or a commitment. Hallelujah. Beloved in the Lord. Why is this word obligation extremely important in our walk with the Lord? Because what we need to really understand as Christians is that the days that we thought, the days that the devil kept giving us ideas that as a Christian, all that I need to do is accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior and then go to bed. The next day I'll be in heaven. Hallelujah. Just go to bed. It doesn't matter how you live your life, as long as you have said, I have given my life to the Lord Jesus Christ, and I've taken him as my Lord and my Savior, and I will live for him. You say you live for him, but you never live for him. Hallelujah. Listen, unfortunately, we are afraid to tell you the truth. I don't know where this fear is coming from. Because the devil himself has tagged people to criticize and to really bash anyone who talks about the truth and speaks that every Christian has an obligation. An obligation to live a certain lifestyle. An obligation to walk in a certain way. You can't live your life anyhow and say that I'm a Christian. A Christian is supposed to live his life in a certain way. Hallelujah. You can't wake up and live your life anyhow. You can't walk around anyhow and then yet call yourself a Christian. The days that everyone told you that, all that you need to do is to accept him as your Lord and Savior, and you did that, and that's excellent. because you can't buy your salvation. And I agree. The Bible says that you cannot buy your salvation. But when you are saved, you have an obligation to live in a certain way. So you go to the Bible. Hallelujah. You know what? Many of us, we've been told that because of grace, because we've been saved by grace, that you will not accept that giving grace calls you to do something. Hallelujah. Grace himself, hallelujah, I said grace himself calls you to something. That someone can leave his basket or a place in the church and someone else will steal it. What kind of life are you living? To come to church as a Christian and steal somebody's basket? Hallelujah. It is sad for some Christians walk around to believe that there's nothing at stake. Hallelujah. We need to understand tonight that we have an obligation. We've been called to something. We have been called to something. We have not been called as ordinary people walking around, living their life anyhow. But we've been called to something. Hallelujah. The very word that says that we save by grace, Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, in verse 10 calls you to work. Hallelujah. Can you quickly give me that scripture? And I want you to really understand, because if you don't understand, you will be living a life thinking that there is no obligation for you. The only thing you were supposed to do is to say that I have accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior. Beloved, even if you live your life and do things without faith, it's a sin. You have an obligation to live by faith. Because the Bible says that without faith, no one can please God. So you have an obligation that if you want to please God, you have to live by faith. We cannot walk anyhow. We cannot take a title upon ourselves and begin to really do things the way we want to do it. Bible says that if you come to Him, it means that you have died to self. How can somebody who has died to something live by that same thing? For it is by grace you have been saved. Yes, we are saved by grace. Through faith, and this is not from yourself, not for myself, neither from yourself, it is a gift of God. Someone decided to send his son to die for you as a gift. And after that, he says in verse 10, for we are God's handiwork, hallelujah, created in Christ Jesus to live our life anyhow. To do what? Which God talked about it today? Since when? Before you were created and your mother gave birth to you, God had planned under some things in advance. He prepared some things in advance for you to do. Hallelujah. So you cannot, as a Christian, now say that, He has prepared something in advance for you. Before you became a Christian, your responsibilities have been prepared in advance. The good works you are supposed to do has been prepared in advance for you to do. So you have an obligation. In fact, the truth is that if you don't know, you have to find it and do it. If you don't know, it's your obligation to find it. God said that the day that Christians sit down like this, pray for me. Give me. But me. How can a male pastor bad Christians, a Christian woman? Hallelujah. Because you have lived your life, you want somebody to bless you, somebody to cook for you, even fasting, you want somebody to fast for you. You have an obligation to fast with your own stomach. Hallelujah. I said the day that people were doing things for you are over, you will die in your faith if you continue like that. Hallelujah. These are the days that God wants you to know your responsibility as a son. Hallelujah. Unless you are not a son. But if you are a son or a daughter, you have responsibilities. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, tonight we pray. Because some chains have to be broken. The chains that have tied us to the old self. That makes us, because you have become a Christian, but you live by the flesh. Now, try and reconcile that to the Bible to see whether it is compatible. It is not. It is not possible. So if you are living by the flesh, how can a Christian see the mercy of God? How can you live consistently with his strength and say the mercy of God? What kind of prayer do you see in you? Because the Spirit of God will prompt you. And if no one is prompting you, if you don't feel anything, ask yourself, what kind of prayer do you see in me? If the spirit that lives in you loves the sin that you commit and doesn't even prompt you and is excited about it, then ask yourself. And you see, what I'm saying, you are not listening. But I want you to hear me. Because if the Spirit of God is living in you, your desire will change. Hallelujah. I said your desire will change. If you are still desiring the things of the flesh, there is a spirit of the flesh that lives in you. Hallelujah. That's why I'm saying that, you see, there are certain things if you preach, you get passion. But it is good. Hallelujah. Paul said that I'm beating. Hallelujah. For me, you can only beat me with your mouth. But Paul was beating with what? With rods, and you have the 40 minus one lashes. How many times? Five. Hallelujah. Our obligation from the scripture we read is not to the flesh. Your obligation as a Christian is not to the flesh. Listen and listen carefully. So, if you are still living to the flesh, then ask yourself, who is living in me? Which spirit is living in me? You haven't thought about it. All that you knew was that little by little, I will be all right. Hallelujah. But the little by little, I'm not disputing that fact that, I mean, you can't be everything in one day. Hallelujah. That's why we grow from faith to faith, from glory to glory. You cannot by one thing, but the point is that the Holy Ghost who lives in you must prompt you. If nobody is prompting you, even if some a human being tells you and you still get offended and angry, ask yourself, who is living in me? Who is living in me? Because if the one living in you is excited about your sin, then that one living in you is not the Spirit of God. I'm telling you the truth. Hallelujah. Then the Spirit of God is not living in you. Amen. Amen. So then, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation. But that obligation is not to our flesh, not to our human nature only, our godliness, our sinful capacity. Watch it and be careful what's going on around all of us. We are much more skewed or drawn towards the things of the flesh, the things of the world, more than the things of the Spirit. And that's a big question mark for us as Christians. Watch it. What are the things of the world? And you will realize that the last thing you consider anytime you run in your schedule, the first thing you consider is about work. Money. Hallelujah. The last thing on the list is church, God, and spirituality. It is only when you have time. Hallelujah. I say it is only when you have what? And therefore, all of us as Christians now, we are pushing our time to everything else. When there is spare time, we need to explain God. Beloved, don't deceive yourself. What you sow is what you reap. If you put God on the sidelines, you will reap on the sidelines. I said, beloved, what you sow is what you will reap. The Amplified says that. So then, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but not to our flesh, our human nature, our worldliness, our sinful capacity. Your obligation is not to satisfy your stomach. Your obligation is not to satisfy your boss at the office. Your obligation is not to do that which you think will give you money in your pocket. You were saved by the blood of the Son of Jesus Christ. And He saved you for a reason. He saved you and made you a son. Hallelujah. And sons, don't behave like slaves. Hallelujah. To live according to the... Listen. We have an obligation, but not to the flesh, to live according to the impulses of the flesh. We live by the impulses of the flesh. When the flesh debuts, that's what we do. That is why, let me tell you something. Many of us, we can't even do. We wake up in the morning, we say, today I'm fasting from 6 to 6 in the evening. But the impulses of the flesh at midday begin to call for food. Hallelujah. And you break the fast. And you begin to eat. Hallelujah. Because the body is calling for something. And you are obeying the impulse of the flesh. Hallelujah. This body that you are obeying will die. It will die. But the spirit that you serve, that you make angry, that spirit is going to be continue to be alive. But there is one day you will be called to account. Okay. According to the impulses of the flesh, our nature without the Holy Spirit. Now watch it. I am not saying it. The Bible is saying it. He's saying that if you do that, watch it carefully. He says, if you do that, what is happening to you? This is not a scripture. Don't watch that. I'm reading from Romans. I don't know what you're doing there. Hallelujah. Our nature without the Holy Spirit is a threat. The way we lived in the past when there was no Holy Spirit in us. Hallelujah. What does it mean? What does it mean? It means that when the Holy Spirit began living in you, you don't live like that anymore. Because if you have a new master inside of you. So you cannot, how can you? That is why, please give me Romans chapter 6, verse 2. Quickly. Is it, how can we, the very ones who died to sin, continue to live in it any longer? Can you add it up? Something that you have died, you died to, how can you live in it any longer? How is that possible? You are dead to something, but you keep living in that same thing. What does it mean? It means you are alive to it. You see, the fact that you are deceiving yourself doesn't mean that you are right. I said, listen, the fact that you are deceiving yourself doesn't mean you are right. You can deceive yourself as much as you want. Hallelujah. You can. And it's possible. And we do that all the time. Hallelujah. You have an obligation. I have an obligation. Not to live according to the flesh anymore. Hallelujah. Okay. For if you are living according to the impulses of the flesh, you are going to die. You are going to do what? But if you are living by the power of the Holy Spirit, hallelujah, you are habitually putting to death the sinful deeds of the body, you will really live forever. Who wants to live forever? Then there is an obligation. You can't just say, I will live forever and then live forever. There is a purpose to do. There is something to be done. Verse 40. For all who are doing what? Not resisting the Spirit of God. Now, watch this. What this means is that He's not coming to beat you. He's not coming to really tie you up. He's not coming to force you to do anything. He comes. But you have to allow yourself to the Lord. To allow myself to be led. If I say I'll go this way, the Holy Spirit is not coming to me. Please tell me, follow me around. He's not doing that. So he says, for all who are allowing themselves to be led by the Spirit are the sons of God. So if he's going this way, go, and you decide to go to this way, who are you? Son of God? Who are you? So, sit up. Ask yourself, who are you? Who are you? Don't take your mask off, let me see your face. Who are you? Who are you? Hallelujah. Okay, come put it back on. Amen. Who are you? Look. Beloved in the Lord, don't joke around with Christianity. Don't joke around with, you see, they have watered it for you, so it has come to a point where you think you can live your life anyhow and go to heaven. So, they're still putting water, more water on it. So now, the garri itself cannot even come up again. It's become water. And because we as Christians today, in quotes, we want to hear what our atheists want to hear, we have intentionally found people who preach life to us. And we are following. So if you preach the truth, you are in danger. Hallelujah. That day is coming. So, you don't even need the word of God to know the truth of God. Hallelujah. If you want to hide something from a Christian, put it in the first page of his Bible. He will never look at it. Hallelujah. Open the Bible, put it in the first page. Travel for 1 year, come back. You can't find it right now. Hallelujah. Put it anywhere else, by the time you can find it. Just put it in the Bible. Because the only thing you will do with the Bible is carry it to church and carry it to home. Even in church, you don't obey it. So every lie we fall for it. Because we don't know the truth. We have an obligation to know the truth. And we have an obligation to live by the truth. For you have not received the spirit of slavery, leading again to fear of God's judgment. Listen to this. Let me explain this to you very well. You, as Christians, we are not living in the fear of God's judgment. Yes, we are children of God. How many children are afraid of their father that they will be going to tell them? You want to put them in some fire somewhere. It will happen. But Hebrews talks about it and he says that the Son has been prepared for the enemies of God. And the Son has not been the enemy of God.
Look, Hebrews chapter 10, quickly. I think verse 27. Quickly. By the time of awful terrifying expectation of divine judgment and the fury of the fire and burning wrath which will consume the adversaries, the enemies, those who put themselves in opposition to God. As a child, do you put yourself in opposition to God? So that fire is not for you. So as a child of God, I'm not living my life thinking about I'm going to go to hell. I know I'm going to go to hell. Hallelujah. Because I'm not living in fear anymore. I am not afraid. That's why, you see, the reason you are afraid of the devil is that you don't even know the one who is in you. Because the Bible says that he who is in you is greater than. So, that is why when you are well positioned in Christ, hallelujah, even before Jesus came on earth, hallelujah, that even when you see thousands of chariots around you, you are not afraid. Because he that is in with you, hallelujah. So, as the party, so celestial that it will go and take Naaman was going to be. Hallelujah. When you behave like Gehazi and go for things like that, you know what happens to you when the Spirit of God is even available, you don't see. So, how can you have Gehazi and Gehazi? Okay. So the two of us are here. I'm sleeping. And then you wake up, you go out and you run back inside. Come and tell me something. What? Enemies plenty? What are you talking about? Charles and all that? Come on. Do you have plenty? Do you see us? Plenty? The truth is that he doesn't even need to go outside and look at what is there. He just tells him because he was assured that those with him are more than those. So he just tells him, open his eyes to see. And then, how many of us are walking in the world but we are blind? How many of us? Yeah, you see me, but you are as blind as anything because you don't see who is here. The Spirit of God is here. And you don't even see. Do you know why you still don't see anything when you sin? Because you don't even see who is around you. You don't even see that. And then his eyes was opened. But let me tell you a secret about God. The truth is that the heart was too much in the flesh. If the heart was in the spirit, he would have understood what's happening. What am I talking about? Before they decided to arrest Elijah, and the army was coming after Elijah, something had happened. Two or three times, they had planned to go and attack his people, and God has always revealed to him, and just told the person, look, the people are coming. They are going to pass through a desert. And then these people will go and follow that path. And then they did it about three times, and they heard that there is somebody who is really giving them the information. There is a party from heaven to give you the information. So everything they plan, the father sits in his room. Elisha sits in his room and is aware of it because God opens his eyes to see. Hallelujah. Now, just excuse my word, the word I'm giving you, but look at the foolishness of men and the flesh. If you are going to attack somebody, he sees and he tells him. And you say, okay, if that is the case, we will arrest him himself so that he won't see again. Hallelujah. The mistakes you are doing is because the devil is leading you. I said, the mistakes you are doing, it is because the devil is leading you. If the devil will lead the people to do that, it tells you how he is. No more words to be used. It tells you. So if you are doing yourself for him to deceive you and tell you that it is not right to serve God the way you are serving, it is not right to give your all to God, it is not right to but what will you eat? When the word of God says that the birds of the earth, they don't work, but they eat. They were not created in the likeness of God, but God looks after them. How much more you who were created in the image of the Almighty God? You have an obligation. There is an obligation for each and every one. If we are the sons of God, he says that, for you have not received the spirit of slavery leading again to fear of God's judgment, but you have received the spirit of what? Adoption as sons. The spirit produces sonship by which we joyfully cry out, Abba, Father. Do you cry out, Abba, Father? Hallelujah. So, now, let me ask you something. Listen to that. A quick question. The Bible says that what father was his son asked for what? And give him what? And he says that if your father, who is of this earth and of this nature, knows what is good for you and you ask, and he will give you what you ask for, how much more him? Unless you are not a son. I said, unless you are not. Because if you are a son, hallelujah, I want you to know your identity tonight. Because that is what is going to inform your decisions. And that is what is going to inform how you live your life from today. Who are you? Are you a son or a slave? Why have we belittled God to this extent? And why are we deceiving ourselves thinking that we can do what we do and so better? We have an obligation not to submit to the flesh, but to submit to the Spirit. And if the Spirit of God is leading you, He will lead you in a certain direction, not the direction you are going. Who you submit to determines how you live your life. Who have you submitted to? And you? Who have you submitted to? A disciple cannot live his life anyhow. disciples of our opportunity. So Jesus himself spoke and said in Luke chapter 9, verse 23. What did he say?
Hallelujah.
He said that every disciple has an obligation. He said, and he was saying to them all, if anyone wishes to follow me as my disciple, the obligation on that person's part is to deny himself first.
Hallelujah.
Set aside what? Me. And as for me, my stomach, so I can fast.
You can deny yourself.
As for me, if I don't go, I will everything. As for me, kill the me. Deny the me. The me says me. You say no.
Hallelujah.
I said, beloved in the Lord, you have lived your life as a fake Christian for far too long. It is the truth. We have lived our lives as fake Christians. The day is coming where we stand before the King of Kings and pretend to be Christian, and there is no pretense there. Because the book of life will be opened. And what you did in secret will be exposed. And you will tell God, I sack myself. I'm going to hell. Don't talk. For what I have already seen in the book, I am going. Hallelujah. You will say, Jesus, so you saw this one too? He said, I saw everything. But don't you open the next page. If you saw this one, the next one is worse. Let me go to hell. Hallelujah. People will beg Jesus, let me go to hell. Because if you saw this one, the Bible says that everything that was done in secret will be exposed. Your pastor didn't see. Your mother didn't see. Your uncle didn't see. Your auntie didn't see. In fact, your husband didn't see and your wife didn't see. But he saw. And it was ready for you. Hallelujah. Stop deceiving yourself. There is an obligation. Deny yourself. Hallelujah. You see, some people say that, it is only these ones, they are more anointed.
What has anointed turned down to you that you hate him?
You don't want to? It's for these ones, which ones? He says, if anyone wishes to follow me as my disciple, now, you say you are not one of them. What do you want to be? You are Jesus' what? Tell me, you are Jesus' what?
Friend?
Or what? Now tell me, who are you? You are Jesus' what? Spectator. Somebody say spectator. You are Jesus' what? Hallelujah. Or you haven't started yet. It's painful, but this is what will save you. The truth is what will save you. The life will take you to hell. The life makes you comfortable, no suffering, nothing. But what is it? He must deny himself, set aside selfish interest, and pick up his cross daily. Expressing a willingness to endure whatever may come. Wait for a Bible, Mona. Expressing expressing a willingness to do what? Is it still, and is endurance still in the Bible, and is it right for Christians to endure? The one is true. I give up. How many times have you given up? I give up. It's not too long ago. Somebody was saying, if this is the way it is, yeah, I can't do this again, no. Go! Who should do? Tell me, who should do? Who? You have to do what? You have to express. Not just have a willingness to endure, but express it. This will be an expression of your willingness to endure. Hallelujah. And not to end. He says, whatever may come, I am willing to endure. Amen. You have to be willing to endure, because if you suffered, you will suffer. Hallelujah. So, carry your cross daily. Expressing a willingness to endure whatever may come and follow me. What does it mean? Believing in me, conforming to my example in living and in, and if need be, suffering or perhaps dying because of faith in me. Oh. Hey, don't go anywhere. I said, don't go anywhere. Where are you going? Come. Don't go anywhere. It's not time to go out. Come. Hallelujah. Nobody should go anywhere. This is for you. Amen. Hebrews chapter 12, quickly, from verse 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, who by faith have testified to the truth of God's absolute faithfulness, stripping off every unnecessary weight and the sin which so easily and cleverly entangles us, let us run with endurance and active persistence the race that is set before us. Go on. Fixing our eyes, he says, looking away from all that will distract us. I said, look away from everything that will distract you. If it is the woman that will distract you, look away. If it is men, look away. If it is cars, look away. If it is money, look away. Anything that will distract you, look away. If it is Facebook, look away. If it is YouTube, look away. If it is Instagram, look away. Whatever it is, Bible says, do what? Look away. Hallelujah. Anything that has a tendency to distract you, look away. If it is your friends, I said, do what? Look away. Cut them off. Let them say you are disappointed. I prefer to be at the choir and go to heaven. Hallelujah. It is time for believers to rise up. It is time for us to rise up. Hallelujah. The world has controlled us for far too long. Everything we want is about the flesh. Everything. Hey, I need a new dress. So what? For what? Amen. Focusing our eyes on who is the author and perfecter of faith, the first incentive for our belief, and the one who brings our faith to maturity. It is not any pastor who brings your faith to maturity. It is Jesus Christ. Any pastor, and listen to me carefully, and I'm not afraid to say this, any pastor that points you to himself is not of God. Every pastor is
supposed to point you to Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I am, if any time I try to point you to myself, I am deceiving you because I can't save you. It is only Jesus who can save. Hallelujah. Let us be bold. Let us be bold. Anyone who points you to himself, I can do this, I can do that. Watch it carefully. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because it is only Jesus. Only Him. Everything we are doing, that is why Paul can sometimes say that when I came to you, I decided not to know anything except Christ and Him crucified. It's not about anybody else. It's not about anything else. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Beloved, we have to really open our eyes because we have an obligation. We have been told for far too long that everything is all right. Nothing is all right. It is not all right. Go into your Bible, you see that you are on the path to hell. You will realize that the road that you are on is too wide. Hallelujah. You see, we are being deceived that our Christianity is not crazy. You don't have to tie yourself with everything. The road is narrow. So, we will be careful. Hallelujah. But the real point to work on ever is you. Hallelujah. That's why when you come to this church, and even what I'm saying, you are angry already. Hallelujah. Why is he always talking about, why is it that he doesn't, and I've heard it for far too long, why is it that he doesn't preach about prosperity? If I know Christ, I've already prospered. Hallelujah. I said, if I know Him, silver and gold belongs to Him. If I have Him in me, I have silver and gold. Hallelujah. Don't let, you see, the truth of the matter is that don't let anybody trick you with anything. The basis of whatever we are sitting here to do is about Jesus. Jesus Himself said to His disciples, don't be eagerly interested in anointing. Be happy. That's what it is. I read it in the book of life. Anybody who tells you that, oh, we are spiritual, no, you are too spiritual, you are too heavenly minded, you are so tell the person, go and read Colossians. Colossians chapter 3, put it there. You see, I'm bombarding you with everything from left, right, center, middle, everything. Colossians, quickly. We'll come back here, but let's go to Colossians. What is the time? Do I have to close or something? Colossians chapter 3. Why? It's taking too long. Is it on your Bible? Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your heart on things in Bacola. And then when you set your mind on things that matter and your heart on things that they tell you that you are too spiritual. Be too spiritual and go to heaven. Hallelujah. Be too spiritual and go to heaven. What does you are? Listen, after all, the Bible is saying that we are not obligated to the flesh, but toward the Spirit. The Spirit doesn't engage in the things of the flesh. The Spirit engages Himself in the things of His Father in heaven. That's where He came from. Hallelujah. Didn't you hear Jesus? He said, I have to go. When I go, I'll bring Him. Did Jesus go down? Where did He go? Don't let anybody deceive you. There's a heaven somewhere. Hallelujah. They did this. Looking at, they didn't look here. They looked here. And they were looking, and the angels came, and they said, the same Jesus you saw going, He will come in the same way. He didn't say He will go like mushroom. He said He will come in the same way. Hallelujah. And what does Thessalonians say? Thessalonians says that there will be a trumpet blast. Angels will blow trumpets, and the King of Kings, He said the heavens will open. He didn't say the earth will open. Hallelujah. I said there is a heaven. Anybody who tells you that a heaven and earth are peaceful, that now. Hallelujah. If heaven is here, Jesus will be here. But He went. Hallelujah.
and he sent the Holy Spirit to come. He said it. He said, I am going, and when I go, I will send you the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. Hallelujah. The Advocate. And the Advocate, your lawyer, and you know what? Hallelujah.
Friday, Mumpai. That's where I met you. Next week, I met you after.
Hallelujah. You've been entangled with things of the world, but you need to begin to break them off. Hallelujah. We need to begin to break them off. There are some things that are bound up. Yachini, all that is in our mind is the world. Hallelujah. If it is not money, it is marriage. If it is not marriage, it is what? If it is not car, it is something else. How many? When was the last time you prayed that, Lord, take me to heaven? When was the last time you prayed that prayer? The Lord, I want to go to heaven. All that you ask God every day, I want a new car, I want a wife, I want a car, I want what? A new building, I want this, I want that. Everything you ask God is for the flesh. When was the last time you asked Him that, let my soul be blessed? When was the last time? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. You choose. You choose. Oh, my Lord. Let your will. From tonight, Lord. Lord, be my guide, be my light. Be my way, be my will. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, be my way, be my will. Oh, my God, come lay your hands. Let your soul say yes to Him and Him alone. Let your soul say yes to Him and Him alone. Let something break off you tonight. Yes. Say yes. Say yes. My soul say yes. My soul say yes.
you, Jesus. Are you sure wherever he leads you are going to follow? That's what he's doing tonight, teaching us to know his way. What moment we choose? Your plan, oh my Lord, let your will be done in me. Guide me, Lord, be the light of my path. Be my way, and be my way, my Lord. Be my life, be my way, be my will, oh my Lord, come lay your hand. These were not your words, they were the songwriter's words. What are you telling Jesus tonight from all that you have heard? What steps do you want to take? What decisions do you want to make this evening? How do you want to walk with him? Are you still going to really stick to your fleshly nature and walk according to the flesh? Or are you going to submit to the Spirit of God and be led by the Spirit of God? What do you want? In your own words, you need to begin from your heart to speak to God. Speak to him right now. Speak to him. Make a decision in your spirit mind, in your soul. Tell God something. I will endure whatever comes my way. Whatever it is, how difficult it is, doesn't really matter. Whatever it is, I'm ready. Whatever may come my way, Lord, I am ready to endure it. I am ready. Give me the grace to walk through it. Give me the grace to stand in the midst of adversity, in the midst of pain, in the midst of suffering, in the midst of the world order. Holy Spirit, grant me grace. That's why you are here. Jesus said that when he goes, he will send you, and you are here. Tell the Holy Spirit. That is why he came. That is why he came. He came to do something in my life and came to do something in your life. Let's call him. Let's call him and talk to him and tell him that, Lord, I don't want to live my life in this way again. I am ready, even if I should die. Ne brota sindelebo sandaya. Ne brota sakaya bababababa. Ne brota sandelebo sandaya. The days of Christianity without commitment, without sacrifice, without any obligation to live our life to please the Father are over. Those days are gone. This is not the time for anybody to pray for you. Begin to learn to intercede for yourself. Begin to learn to speak to him yourself. Begin to learn to stretch forth your hands towards him. Libra Kafenderebo Sakaya. Talk to the Father, talk to the Son, talk to the Holy Ghost. Let it come from inside of you.
Let your spirit, your inner man speak tonight. Let your spirit speak to the spirit of God tonight. Cry unto him. I said nobody's praying for you tonight. You have to cry to him. Nobody's conceding you tonight. You have to stretch forth your faith and catch him in heaven. Touch him tonight. Touch him tonight. Touch him tonight. Touch him tonight. He's ready for you. I said he's ready for you. Touch him tonight. Touch him tonight. Touch your Holy Spirit tonight. Touch the Spirit of God tonight. Cry unto your clarity this year. Cry unto him, begin to do something about your life. Call unto him in your time of need, and he will hear you. This is a moment of need, a moment that you need the Holy Ghost to begin to lead you, to lead you, to guide you, to direct you. He broke a fender of Zodiah. Male broke a fender of Zodiah. Call unto him. Something must break off you tonight. The Holy Ghost has to do something about your life tonight. He knows you. If you will call on him, he will come to you. I said nobody pray for anybody tonight. You will have to touch him tonight. You have to touch him tonight. Stretch forth your hands over and touch him. Let him do something new in your life tonight. Let something break off you tonight. He will do a different kind of deliverance in you tonight. If you can call on him, if you can stretch forth your hands towards him, if you can yield to him tonight, if you can tell him that doesn't matter what I go through, I am standing up with you tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, your children are opening up your spirit and they have gratitude. Father, in the name of Jesus, according to your word, we have an obligation to live according to the Spirit and not to the flesh. Father, but we have lived according to the flesh for far too long. But tonight, Holy Ghost, tonight, Holy Spirit, tonight, Holy Spirit, we have come to you. You know every part of this place, and you know what your children have cried unto you for tonight. I know already you are beginning a good work in each and every one of us. Already you have begun a work. I pray that you come unto you this day. May the work that you have begun be brought to an expected end. I will make us stronger. That you make us stronger. Stronger by all the time. That will make us willing to endure whatever it is you bring to me. I pray for every soul here today. Holy Ghost, I pray for every single soul. May the word that you have sent to them this morning, that this evening, continue right now to generate light. May you be the good day for us. And may this word begin to find a journey through a good day. I pray to you. For I know that you have already begun to work in your life. And Lord, if you trust that, you have done it continually. May you begin to see your fruits very soon. May your children mature. May your children begin to manifest your glory. In our lifestyle, that we are the children of God and sons of the Most High God. May we begin to show to the world that we are co-heirs with Jesus Christ. May we begin to show the world that we are royals, Lord. Rest on me, this life we have. But may we begin to show the world that we are not beggars. Just lift up your breath and lift up your voice. Thank you. those are beautiful persons in this room. We lift the prayer of the one before you tonight. And we ask in the name of Jesus. Give us the breath of life over the breath of the living bread to us. Bring in life into the bread and make it a body of Christ. And bring in life into the church. For this moment, we hold not bread and juice, but we hold in our hands the body of Christ and the blood of Jesus Christ. As we pray in Jesus' name, for we desire to walk and live according to your will. May the body of Jesus Christ and the blood of Jesus continue to give us new strength, new life, new direction. May we be quickened and equipped and empowered as we eat and drink the body and the blood. And may our lives, O God, be transformed from today. May we begin to go after the Spirit because of the body and because of the blood of Jesus that really begins to live and move in us tonight. Spirit of God, we thank you. Spirit of the living God, we thank you. We are here in your presence with great understanding that we're not eating bread and drinking juice, but we're eating the body of Jesus Christ and drinking his blood. And may that power in his body, in his blood, begin to manifest in our lives so that we will begin to walk, live, and move according to your will. We thank you, Holy Ghost. We thank you, Spirit of God. Begin to touch us. From this cup of blood of the covenant in the remembrance of Jesus Christ. Father, by the power of the Spirit, I bless your children. I pray in the name of Jesus. May our lives to begin to give us new strength to endure and to persevere, to live the life that you call us to live, and walk and live as overcomers in Jesus' name. Beloved, lift up your offering and your tithes and your feet. Whatever you want to give to the Lord tonight, just lift it up. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name. In obedience to your word, we give a tenth of what you have given us. And in obedience to your word, we give our free will offering. And even in obedience to your word, we sow a seed. And I pray right now, the Lord in Jesus' name, may you receive the tithes. And may you open the windows of heaven
and give unto your children according to your word. And Lord, may you receive, O God, in Jesus' name, the freewill offering, and may you, by the power in your name, give back unto us good measure, praise, sticking together and running over. And Lord, in Jesus' name, may every seed that is sown tonight bear fruit of a 60, a 100, and even more to the glory of God. We thank you that it has been received by you. And Lord, in Jesus' name, you have given us. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we agree with the songwriter that we will sit and go with you. We will love what you love, and we will do what you do. Father, we thank you tonight. May your word that you have received tonight, Father, be a true word that will bring great transformation in our lives. We honor you with our bodies. We honor you with our lives. We honor you.